and welcome to Ask Me Doctor Season 2, a video series for you parents to learn more about your children's health. I'm Hazel from motherhood.com.my. In the previous season, we have cleared up some misconceptions during pregnancy. This time round, we're gonna debunk more myths, but we'll focus on children's health. Today, we are very fortunate to have Dr. Fu, pediatrician from Dr. Fu Child Specialist Clinic, to help us to dispel 10 common myths that you have submitted earlier on our Facebook. Hello, Dr. Fu.
Hi, Hazel.
Number 6, diarrhea can be contagious, so keep your children away from other children who have diarrhea.
First of all, if you say just because by sharing the same room or the same lift or even sleep on the same bed with another child with a diarrhea, you will surely get diarrhea too, then it is not true. But again, there are some diarrhea that are caused by infection. Especially true in rotavirus infection or typhoid infection. The pathway for the infection is fecal material to the mouth. This pathway from fecal material to the mouth. So usually it is by hands contaminated by feces that are not hand washed properly, and then they touch on surfaces, or they contaminated the food, and which is then passed on to another person who also forgets to wash their hands, or they eat contaminated drinks and food, which would then cause an infection in their intestine. Yeah. The pathway must be touching. So hand hygiene is very important. So I always tell parents that just by sleeping in the same room, you won't get it. It is very different from respiratory infections. There are also a lot of diarrhea that are not related to infection at all. So the person may be having a malabsorption due to lactose intolerance, or because take too much antibiotics, you get antibiotic associated diarrhea. So these are not infective diarrhea. There are also patients who are having a dengue fever or influenza infection who has a parental diarrhea, means they have diarrhea as a side symptom of their infection, but they do not carry any germs in their fecal material. So they are not, the kind of diarrhea is not infectious, but they are infectious in other ways. So it's not correct to just overgeneralize to say that diarrhea is contagious, so you have to go far away kind of thing. But hand hygiene is paramount, very important to prevent this kind of food poisoning, to prevent this kind of hygiene related illnesses.
Number 7, exposure to the cold weather causes cold.
Not true. I think in Malaysian context, I think you are talking about playing in the rain, right? So you'll catch a cold if you play in the rain. So I do not agree at all. I'm the kind of person who enjoy running in the rain, unless it's too heavy kind of rain. If it's drizzling, it's a perfect weather to run, and I do not fall sick. I think the core factor for a strong immune system is not whether you play in the cold or exposed to cold weather or not. It's actually more about whether your strong immune system, whether you have a good diet, a balanced lifestyle, a healthy lifestyle, adequate sleep, eat proper food and a healthy environment. Those are more important. So if your child is eating healthily, have adequate rest and sleep, growing up well with all the nutritious kind of food, just by playing in the rain for a while or exposed to the cold weather for a while, should not make them sick.
Question number 8. If your child has a speech or language delay, it's nothing to be concerned about, as children usually overcome these problems with age.
I think the main message here is that no, we cannot just take it for granted that as the child grows older, for sure the child will learn how to speak. I think while it is also true that some may be a bit slower to pick up, and then they will end up they are those late bloomers, and after the age of 2, they may be a bit slower, but they end up able to speak so well later on in their life. But there are also a group of children who is very obviously having a speech delay, and we must make sure that they do not have hearing impairment, because a hearing problem will also lead to inability to pick up the speaking, because we learn speaking by mimicking sounds, And also we must make sure that they do not have social interaction problem, the social development disorder such as autism, they also have difficulty to learn to verbally communicate, and also non-verbal communication as well. Another thing to consider is learning disability. So children who have a speech delay, we must make sure that they do not have a learning disability, features of autism or hearing impairment. If they do have these kind of symptoms, we should expose them for early intervention so that we can really help them to resolve some issues, to improve, to help them to achieve speech ability as soon as possible. I think that you can easily find those developmental milestones in even online on reputable websites, or you talk to your pediatrician. My expectation is very low compared to kindergarten teachers. I think pediatrician expectations are very low. It doesn't raise a red flag until really, really certain features are not met. For example, we expect a baby at 1 year of age should be able to maybe to call mama, dada, to start to babble, you know. And I think receptive component of the language ability is very important. Even though they may not speaking yet, but they should be able to understand simple command. Even after
response to it.
Yes, after one year of age, they should turn to their name. When their name is called, they should understand yes or no kind of command. When you are 18 months, you know, 1.5 years old, you should be able to point to at least three body parts. Like, where is your ear? Where is your eye? Where is your mouth? They should be able to point. And then by the time they are 2 years old, they should be able to speak short sentences about 2 to 3 words. There's a broad spectrum of expectation here. But my key point is that even when they're not speaking yet, you should be able to tell that they are able to understand your words, like they can understand the language, you know. Comprehension is important. If they cannot understand anything you say, they do not respond to any of your instructions, and they have poor eye contact, they're just in their own world, then it really raises a red flag, and we should take action. We cannot just say, never mind, now wait until they are bigger, then they can talk. It may not work that way. Yeah. Another thing is that they may not use their mouth, like verbal language, but non-verbal communication will also tell that they will be able to achieve a verbal language later on. Like they'll be pointing to things, that they want this, they want that, or if they're hungry, they may point to the bread, or they can also use some baby words like mom, like, you know, not real words, but those indicate that they have the ability, they have the kind of speech and language ability. So those are good signs that they are going to achieve that soon. But if at the age of between 1 to 2 they do not demonstrate that kind of pattern at all, then it does raise an alarm. We should be more attentive and consider to take further action.
Number 9, most children will go through terrible 2.
Terrible 2s, is it true or not? For many parents, it is very obvious, you know. For the observation, it's obvious. But I would say that there is no timeline. You cannot have a timeline to say that, oh, once you enter the age of 2, for sure your child will be terrible, and then when you are 3 years old, then you graduate from the terrible hood. It doesn't work that way, lah. I would say at any age, a baby, an infant, or a toddler can have their very cute, very sweet moments, and also very terrible, difficult moments. Your child is exploring the world. They are exploring, they're learning about their surroundings, they are testing the limits of themselves, they're testing the limits of their parents, the people around them. So it is an emotional roller coaster. Sometimes they can get frustrated. Sometimes they want to have the cake and eat it too. They cannot make decisions. It's a dilemma for them, and you know. And all these are frustrating times, and they can throw tantrums. And also at the age of 2, coincidentally, their speech development are getting better, so they can talk well, they can talk back, they can understand most of your language, so they tend to react in a way that can be more responsive and more rebellious. They can also start to be very mobile, because by the age of 2 they can walk so well, they can run and climb so well as well. The difficulty become more obvious, but it's not that to say that you are for sure going to be terrible and difficult when you are 2. I think the difficult experience as a parent can happen.
Sometimes the challenges doesn't stop at 2. Increases as they age.
I think all this is how they develop, how they learn their surrounding, how they reach. They get in peace with what are their limits.
Question number 10. Using a baby walker will help a toddler walk sooner.
Actually, the walker does not help the child to walk independently. does not make them learn faster how to walk independently. Instead, it's actually encouraging the baby to use their buttock muscles to propel themselves forward. So they're actually bottom shuffling. So babies who use too much walker will end up bottom shuffle instead of crawling and then learning to walk earlier than expected. So it is a misnomer to call that object as a walker because it does not help your child to walk faster.
Before we close this, is there anything you would like to add, Dr. Tu?
Yes, I would like to say that our knowledge and understanding is not absolute and conclusive. We are still learning. Even doctors are learning. Whatever we say now today, we accept universally as facts today, may one day be exposed as untrue or not accurate anymore by future studies. So we are always learning. So that's why a lot of research and studies are being done to understand more. So let's keep an open mind what we know about parenting and healthcare evolving. Do not jump into conclusions and because sometimes some myths can be dangerous while some myths are harmless, but it is always good to keep an open mind and let's learn together continuously.
Alright, thank you Dr. Fu for helping us to debunk our top 10 common myths that submitted by our fans. For more videos about our children's health, stay tuned for our upcoming videos on Ask Me Doctor. I'm Hazel.
I'm Dr. Fu.
This is motherhood.com.my.